The freshman transition program, what are we? So we are quite aware that students will open up that offer letter saying you have the opportunity to be part of this freshman transition program. And so many of them and their families go, what in the world is a freshman transition program? So we are a partnership between Towson University and CCBC, the Community College of Baltimore County. So this partnership, this program is an exclusive participation opportunity where university admissions has looked at your application for admission and has determined based on your current academic record that you could be a good fit for this program and be a candidate for full admission to Towson University. So we're an alternative admission pathway. If your goal is to get to Towson University and earn your four-year degree from TU, our program is the fast track to getting you to accomplishing that goal. So if you want a degree from Towson, the FTP, you come to the right place. So we'll talk a lot more about what that transition looks like throughout the presentation. But being part of the FTP, accepting your offer of participation to join the program, gives you the opportunity to have the lived-in experience of any first semester incoming Towson University student. So the experience of the FTP student is the experience of any other Towson Tiger. And we really strive to keep everything as equal playing field and make sure that all of our students have access to the same opportunities for engagement, academic and social supports as any other student at Towson. The only difference, the only nuance being that our FTP students are taking CCBC classes as opposed to Towson University classes. So we'll talk about the schedule and what specific classes you can expect to be taking as part of the program, but these are generally the same first semester foundation courses that any other incoming Towson student takes. They're equal level of difficulty, they're the same course. It's just that the credit is being awarded by CCBC as opposed to Towson University. And these courses are taught by CCBC faculty. So they are handpicked by the academic departments here at CCBC to teach specifically for this program. Traditionally, faculty that have taught for this program before, they understand the nuances of the program and the unique needs of our FTP students. And it's really a great fit that we aim to achieve with our enrollment because we keep our class sizes small. So those kind of traditional kind of community college class sizes that you might be familiar with, maybe about 25 to 30 students per one instructor, that's what we aim for with the FTP as well. So you might be thinking of kind of those famous lecture halls that you might see in the movies or even elsewhere at Towson where there are hundreds of students in a lecture hall, whereas our program, we're focusing deliberately on small class sizes to really build on that in-depth instruction, allowing for interaction between the students and their faculty, and being able to bond with each other as FTP students in these courses. So lots and lots of benefits to being part of this program, again, that we'll talk about throughout the presentation. But one of the great benefits of being part of the program is the opportunity to utilize on-campus housing. So if you want to live at Towson University and you want to be part of the FTP, as long as you submit your housing application by the deadline, then you have guaranteed on-campus housing at Towson, just like any other Towson freshman that applies by the deadline. There is one single bill, and we'll talk a lot more about the billing and financial aid structure of the program later in the presentation, but it's one single bill that FTP students pay. It's paid initially upfront to CCBC, and that bill incorporates CCBC tuition, so the community college prices for our courses, as well as university fees. So we'll talk a lot more about specifically what the bill entails later in the presentation, but know that it won't be two separate bills that you have to pay to two separate schools like it was in the past days of the program. It's one single bill and a really streamlined process as far as paying that bill. So the great, 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 greatest benefit of this program is if you take the opportunity to be part of it, submit your contract to join the program, and you successfully complete the program, and we'll talk more about what successful completion of the program entails, then you have guaranteed admission to the university without having to reapply for admission. So if you're with the FTP in as little as one semester, you can be fully admitted to the university. You get to transfer all of these credits that you'll be earning through CCBC by way of this program. and go right along with the progression of your undergraduate degree at Towson. And as I said, most students can accomplish this in as little as one semester. So as early as spring 2024, you can be fully admitted to the university. So we'll talk more about what that pipeline looks like in just a second. But Becca, if you could take us to the next slide. Thank you. So the transition requirements, that's to say the academic criteria that every student has to meet by way of the program in order to be fully transitioned into the university. So let me begin by saying participation in this program is for a maximum of 2 consecutive semesters. So we are the freshman transition program the first year. So as I've said, generally, typically, students are with us for only the fall semester and are fully admitted to the university as early as their spring semester. The opportunity to continue in the program for a second semester is based on academic need only. In other words, if a student meets the criteria that we've outlined to transition after the first semester, then they move on. They don't have the option to continue in the FTP unless they do not meet those criteria to transition. Then, as long as they have a 2.0 GPA or better from the fall semester, they have an opportunity to continue in the program, be measured against a new set of criteria to then hopefully be fully admitted and transition to Towson for their second year. So at the end of the fall semester, students are required to meet all of the criteria that you see before you. So they have to complete at least 9 transferable credits. Most of our students have more than that. They also need at least a 3.0 fall semester GPA, no final grade less than C, and they have to maintain full-time enrollment. So as I said, we'll talk about the schedule later in the presentation, but know that all students start out the semester with 5 classes or 15 billable hours. They're required to maintain full-time enrollment, which is at least 4 classes. So if you're thinking, well, why is there a differential there? We do allow students to withdraw up to one class throughout the semester. If they are struggling, if they're in danger of failing, we do give them the right to withdraw from up to one class. So if they don't meet those criteria, and again, they have to meet all of them, if they don't meet the criteria to transition, they have the opportunity to continue in the program for a second semester as long as they have a 2.0 GPA or better. And this is the current population of the FTP that we're working with. That's to say students who didn't transition from fall, they have a second chance to continue in the program, and they're looking to be fully admitted for the start of their second year. So those criteria change just a bit for the second semester. We look for a 2.5 cumulative GPA or better, in addition to having 15 total transferable credits. Again, most of our students are transferring much more, and no final grade than C if enrolled in developmental coursework. So we'll talk more about what developmental coursework is, again, in just a few minutes in the presentation. But do know that over 2,100 FTP students have successfully transitioned into the program since the program started back in 2008. So we have a long demonstrated history of academic success that we look forward to improving upon with each year and transitioning more students into the university by way of this program. Becca? Thank you. So FTP courses, as I've said, FTP students are registered for 5 classes, and they're registered for their 5 classes by me as the program coordinator. So if that sounds a little bit unfamiliar to you, know that first semester students at Towson also have their schedules pre-made by academic advising. So there is actually no incoming student to the university for the fall who's a freshman that gets to make their own schedule. Well, you might think, well, why is that? So the FTP class schedule is very limited in terms of the classes that we offer and when we're able to offer them. So because of how limited our schedule is, as the program coordinator, I have to tightly manage it. So again, each student is registered for 5 classes. And as I said previously, these are the same classes generally that first semester freshmen are also taking at Towson. The only difference being it's the CCBC equivalent course of that Towson course. So English Composition or English 101 and Math are first semester foundation courses for all incoming freshmen at CCBC and Towson. So our students follow suit with that. every student takes English 101, every student takes math depending on their placement result. So we'll talk more about placement testing again later in the presentation, but know that the placement testing process is in place to ensure that students are placed or registered for the appropriate math course that meets their skill set with where they are as they're coming into the fall semester. So, and again, we'll talk about placement testing, but non-credit math courses, if a student places into a non-credit math, these are non-college level, but they are designed to be developmental to give the students a foundation that they need to be successful in college level math as they make their way up to college level. Developmental coursework does not carry transferable credit because it's not college level. However, it does meet prerequisites for higher level coursework at the university. So we'll talk more about that shortly, but just know that if you're seeing, for an example, a Math 082, that notes introductory algebra, which would not be a college level course, but a student would take that as the first step in their progression to college level math. So we'll talk more on that in just a few minutes. You'll see just from this graphic that I put together here to visualize the schedule that the majority of our classes do begin at 5 p.m. and later. And the reason is because of the limited classroom availability at Towson. So if you think about it, Towson utilizes their classroom space during prime times, morning, early afternoon. So that's not to say that there aren't Towson classes going on when the FTP classes are meeting, but as you might imagine, there's more classroom availability later in the day, which is why our courses are typically held later in the day. So we do our best to be accommodating of our students as much as we possibly can. We know that it's a little bit of a drag to go to a 6:30 to 9:10 class, you know, four nights a week. So we do our best to be fair in terms of our scheduling and try to limit the late classes that our students have, keeping in mind that 6:30 to 9:10 would be our latest time slot, and each student can be expected or can expect to be enrolled in at least probably 2 to 3 6:30 to 9:10 sessions, generally speaking. So as I said earlier, we aim for small class sizes. So between 20 to 25 students generally per class, and that's in line with the enrollment maximums over on the CCBC side. And your schedule, your fall class schedule, if you join the program, will be available to you in June. So you might think to yourself, well, how do I know what classes I'm gonna end up with in the meantime? Becca, I'm sorry, could you take me back? Thank you. So you might think, well, how am I going to know or how can I anticipate what kind of classes that I would be taking if I have to wait till June? So again, every student will be taking English, every student will be taking math, and generally the three other courses that you'll be registered for they'll all meet core requirements for graduation at the university. So think general education courses. Typically, they're in arts and humanities or social and behavioral sciences, like intro to psychology, for example, intro to sociology, fundamentals of communication. These are just examples. And again, we do assign these pretty strictly in terms of scheduling based on when we have the classes and when we're able to schedule. But know that we also have an academic interest form that we ask students to submit electronically, where you can indicate types of classes that may be of more personal interest to you. And we'll do our best to take that into account as we do the planning for your fall semester schedule. And if there are any classes that we're offering that actually are a direct requirement for your intended major, for example, if you're a nursing major and intro to psychology is one of the foundation courses for that major, then I would certainly do my utmost to have you scheduled for that course for the fall semester. So it's very much like putting together a puzzle in terms of scheduling for FTP students. And that's what I'll be undertaking as we go into June. And again, you can expect to have your schedule created for you by the end of June by me. Becca, we can move on, thank you. So as I said earlier, the FTP experience really is the Towson Tiger experience with some special nuances. So our FTP students receive program specific advising. So incoming Towson students have what they call a first year experience advisor. FTP students have one as well. They'll work with that advisor for the entire first year. So even if you transition after the first semester, which is our goal for you, you'll still be working with that advisor and building upon the relationship that you've developed in the fall semester throughout your entire first year. year. So this is an academic advisor on the Towson side that has been recruited, hired specifically to work with FTP students. They'll receive FTP specific training to understand, again, the nuances of our program, the unique needs of our students. And students are required to meet with their advisor once a month. So that would be done through a variety of either one-on-one meetings or group advising meetings, which I help lead. So we'll talk a lot more about academic advising and our model for advising throughout the summer, but just know that intentional advising is a huge part of what we do within the FTP model. We also have peer mentoring. So this is a wonderful opportunity for students to connect with a current non-FTP student at the university to kind of branch out their social reach, get to know the Towson community better, campus community better, and to make a buddy who's outside of the FTP and have a formulate a relationship with that person. And again, improve your connectiveness, become a part of the Towson community. So peer mentoring, we really hope that as many students utilize that as possible. We just piloted it last year. So we're looking forward to seeing what more we can do with it as we head into this fall. We also have tutoring in all disciplines that is available to FTP students, just like any other incoming Towson student. And these services are covered within the university fees that all students pay. So know that this is essentially tutoring that you are absolutely entitled to, that you're paying for by way of these fees. So we always encourage students to utilize tutoring through the university, which includes math tutoring, writing center tutoring, and again, for all of the arts and humanities and social and behavioral science disciplines that we teach through the program. Our students have access to health and counseling services through the university, just like any other Towson student, and they get a campus ID card or a one card. So access to campus events and facilities and entertainment, anything that's accessible through a one card, banking on campus. Our students can do all of that through their one card as well. They also can take out a meal plan, which is required if you're living on campus, but if you're commuting, you certainly have the option to buy into a meal plan. We offer parking for commuter students. So if you're living on campus, you're not eligible to purchase a parking permit, but if you are commuting, then you have the opportunity to buy a permit and park at Towson, park on Towson's campus, as well as being able to join almost all of the clubs and organizations at Towson University. Couple of conditions with that, you know, you don't want to join a club if it meets at the same time you have a class. So trying to be mindful of those things. And on the academic interest form that I referenced earlier, one of the questions is, do you have any interest in participating in a club? What club, kind of choose from a drop-down list? And I do try to take those sorts of preferences into account when building your schedule. No guarantees, but we do our best to find out what you're interested in and try to accommodate those interests as much as we can when we do your class scheduling. A few limitations though, as far as involvement. So FTP students cannot participate directly in Greek life. That's to say they can't pledge for a Greek organization until they've transitioned from the program because they're not quite full Towson admits. So if you're looking forward to pledging a fraternity, gentlemen, you can look forward to doing that for your second year. And sororities, if I'm not mistaken, don't rush until the spring semester. So if you're a female and you're looking forward to participating in Greek life, you actually can rush in the spring semester if you've transitioned. We certainly encourage you to attend Greek events throughout the fall semester. So just because you can't officially join the organization, we welcome you to network and get involved if you're interested in Greek life. Another condition is competing for the university. So you can't do D1 or club sports while you're in the FTP, nor practice with them, but you can absolutely utilize those opportunities once you've transitioned from the program. So I always say, if there's a contact that you've made within athletics or you have questions about how to join a club sport, you know, certainly inquire, make those connections while you're in the FTP and know that you can take advantage of those fully once you've transitioned out of the program. And the two other quick conditions to mention in there, Army ROTC is not available to FTP students until after they transition into the university if you're interested in that, as well as federal work studies. So we encourage our students to work on Towson's campus if they want to. They can work anywhere if they want to. It's just that federal work study isn't something that is available to our students until they've transitioned into the university. So we can talk more about that as we get into the financial aid piece. But moving into the next part of our talk. So this is a video that was put together several years ago with FTP students who have transitioned into the university and talking about the experience that they had in the program. So this is about 3 minutes long, and we look forward to sharing with you the FTP student perspective from former students. So Becca, if you will.
Well, originally I wanted to go to Towson University, but I was put on a waitlist for a while.
I really wanted to go to Towson, and originally I was waitlisted.
When I got the letter, I didn't quite understand what it was.
I got a letter in the mail saying that I got accepted into some program called the Freshman Transition Program. So if I really wanted to go to Towson, then I would have to participate in this program.
And I was really excited because this means I'm not in Towson per se, but I'm going to be in Towson.
FTP offered me a spot to participate in their program, and I was really, really excited.
I felt like it was giving me a second opportunity to get into Towson University.
And FTP gave me that opportunity to still come to Towson and take courses that were still rigorous and take college courses, live on campus, get the campus experience.
Some Towson students have night classes too, so it's pretty much the same thing. It's just you have a different professor than, you have a CCBC professor rather than a Towson professor.
Any other college just didn't feel right. Towson was pretty much the only place I toured and really wanted to go.
My transition from high school to FTP was really good.
It's just like any other freshman person getting transferred.
It gave me the foundation that I needed to start college and become a really successful undergraduate.
My typical day as an FTP student was I would go to work in the morning,
so I'd spend them like with my friends, studying, getting to know other people, going to the events that I could.
Usually my classes didn't start till around 3:30.
I would have classes typically until about maybe 9 at night.
I joined the African Diaspora Club.
I got involved through Love is Louder. It was a program that was originally started by Brittany Snow and the Jed Foundation.
Thursday night trivia, I was always there when I got out of class. And I met some really good friends there.
Went to the job fair, I got a job, and I focused on my classes and my work. And both of those things kept me organized, and I was definitely always ready for my classes and always ready for work.
All the staff of FTP, all the professors I had were really, really caring.
They're easy to just approach and ask any questions.
It was really, really a nice support network we had.
I have the help that I need. I have pretty much the same help that a typical Towson student needs.
The professors gave me a lot of advice on what I need to do to prepare for becoming a full Towson student.
They even sent out my grades to me, courtesy, saying, hey, you're on track, good luck. And if I wasn't, they would say, hey, you kind of need to step up your game, but we're here to help.
I would absolutely recommend the program to anyone who got an acceptance to FTP.
I would recommend the program to anyone who is asked to participate in it, because
it's a great way for you to get involved with Towson before you even get into Towson.
They make you realize that you are still in college, but you just need to take these extra steps in order to be prepared.
You may be taking community college courses, but you're taking them as part of the greater Towson community, and there's absolutely nothing greater than that.
Thank you for that, Becca. Moving back into our presentation, see, this could be you one day. Successfully complete the program, and then you can promote for us to recruit future FTP students. So thank you again, Becca, for sharing that. So let's turn our attention to math placement testing. As you know, hopefully, all incoming FTP students are required to complete math placement testing as part of the process to join the program. So our very first math placement testing sessions will be held this Friday, March 10th. So the process is very clearly outlined on our website as far as placement testing and how to sign up and what the procedure entails. So you want to make sure that you're reading that closely. So the first step to sign signing up, the first step to placement testing is to sign up for a date. And when you sign up for that placement testing session, you will receive a confirmation email. Within that confirmation email is going to have all of the specifics of the session that you registered for. So the date, the time, and do bear in mind that all testing has to be completed in person at Towson University in accordance with the dates that are posted on our website. So again, you'll receive that confirmation with all of the specifics, telling you where to go on campus to access that placement test, which will be in Cook Library. And within that confirmation is a code that you will then use to access the Alex website. You'll see that graphic on the left-hand side of the slide. So you'll navigate to Alex and you'll create your user account. So this is our placement testing platform. You'll create your user account. And within the platform, you will take a practice test, which is strictly for diagnostic purposes. It does not count for your actual placement in your math class for the fall semester. But from the practice test, will be created prep and learning modules. So these are essentially review modules that you'll complete after the practice test. The practice test will actually design the module for you and focus on areas that you may need to work on based on how you answered the practice test. And the whole point of this process is to give you as much customized review, intensive review as possible, so that you're as well prepared to take the proctored test at the university as you possibly can be. So you will not be able to access the proctored test when you come to Towson to take the test unless you've gone through the process and created your Alex account, taken the practice test, and logged at least 3 hours minimum of review in the prep and learning module. So the Alex system tracks all of this. So you want to make sure that you're working through the process carefully, that you're reaching out to me if you have any questions as you're going through the process, because ultimately you do not want to arrive for your in-person testing date if you're unprepared, because you won't be able to access the proctored test. The system will not allow it. Know that the test is untimed. So if time is a concern, or if you're someone who has accommodations for extended test taking time for your high school courses currently, extended time is already built into the test itself. That is the only accommodation that we are able to implement within the regular testing session. So with that, I say that if you need a handheld calculator or any other special accommodation, you will need to work with the university's accessibility and disability services team to be set up to complete proctored testing with them in their office space to ensure that you're receiving the accommodations that you may be entitled to through your documentation. So if you have any questions about this, or if you have accommodations and you think that this might be applicable to you outside of extended test taking, please reach out to me first. So you want to do that instead of just signing up for a testing session and coming to take the test during our general testing session, because we cannot approve the use of handheld calculators regardless of documentation. It has to be done. It's only authorized to be done through the university's accessibility and disability services team. So if you take a proctored test without accommodations, and maybe you're afforded accommodations later, you can certainly retest within the ADS office. Just keep in mind, if there's any hesitation or any confusion about accommodations, please reach out to me first so that we can verify all of that before you come to campus and take the proctored test, because we want to make sure that you're equipped to receive the right supports, again, depending on what your accommodations entail. So reach out to me if you have any questions so that I can connect with the Accessibility and Disability Services Office on your behalf if we need to. Students are required, as I mentioned earlier, to meet minimum placement testing results. So our minimum math course is introductory algebra. So students have to meet that placement or better in order to pursue their admission to the program. If you don't meet the minimum placement after your first proctored attempt, we require you to come back and retest for a higher placement. So you'll want to make sure to do that if you don't meet the minimum requirement. And know that I will be meeting with students very briefly, since I have a lot of students to chat with as they finish placement testing. I will be providing you with specific follow-up regarding your score and your placement that you'll be able to take with you. It's a very detailed flyer that you can share with your family and then make your next steps determining based on your placement and any retesting that might be required. So again, it is required if you don't meet that minimum 082 placement. It is optional if you meet a higher placement. So that's to say intermediate algebra. And for students that place directly into college level math, we do not require them to retest because college level math is as high as we go in terms of our placements. So essentially, if you place into 082 or 083 math, you can come back and retest if you'd like to for a higher placement. The better score of the two attempts will be honored for your final placement. And if you test and do not meet the 082 minimum, then you are required to come back and retest to see if you can make a higher placement. And keep in mind that if you are retesting, you'll be required to log an additional 5 hours in that prep and learning module. Remember, the initial is 3 hours of prep and learning review. Again, just to make sure that you're as well prepared as possible when you come in to test to make the best score that you possibly can. So all placement testing first attempts are required to be completed by April 21st, which is the deadline to join the program. So as you may have read throughout the website, space within the program is limited. So you're on the right track already by attending an information session. Hopefully you're already signed up to complete placement testing. And once you've tested and you've met the minimum or exceeded the minimum placement, we want you to submit that participation agreement and your non-refundable enrollment fee right away to cement your spot in the program. Because if we do reach capacity prior to that April 21st date, if you're in the queue to complete placement testing, we'll work with you. But any student that hasn't already registered for placement testing, if we've already met that capacity, then we're unable to admit additional students to the program. So my point being here is do not delay to move forward with the process for completing placement testing and then submitting your participation agreement once you have finished testing. And we really emphasize it to be in that order. Test first, then officially commit to the program, because we want to make sure that you've met or exceeded that minimum placement of Math 82 or higher. So on to the next slide, please. So how to join the freshman transition program. I've touched on some of this already. So be mindful, what you've received so far is an offer to participate in the freshman transition program. You're not officially part of the FTP until you've completed placement testing and submitted that non-refundable enrollment fee, which again is due by April 21st, but we want you to submit it as early as possible once you finish placement testing. So you'll want to go and follow the to-do list that's on our website. So all of the steps are very explicitly outlined in terms of what you need to do by when. So make sure that you're looking at that carefully and reaching out to me if you have any questions. Once you have officially joined the program, you'll be prompted to activate your Towson student email account, which will be the primary form of communication for this program. So right now we'll work with your personal email account because that's all we have. But once you've officially joined the program, all of the official communication from me, from my financial aid liaison, everyone affiliated with the program is going to go through your Towson email account. So we'll talk about the importance of checking your email account again in the presentation as we get to our financial aid and billing piece. As I mentioned earlier, you do have the option for on-campus housing. So if you are interested in housing, submit your housing application before the May 1st deadline. So you'll placement test, you'll commit to the program, you'll then submit your housing application. If interested, you are not required to live on campus. So if you live close to campus and you're happy being home with mom and dad and just want to commute, that's perfectly acceptable, but know that you have to apply by May 1 for housing to get the guaranteed on-campus housing. We'll talk more about financial aid in just a couple of minutes, actually, but all financial aid will be processed for this program by CCBC. So you'll want to direct all financial aid to CCBC as we're heading into the summer to make sure that everything's in place for you to receive aid for the program. As I mentioned earlier, there's the academic interest form that we'd like you to complete by June 1st once you've officially committed to the program. In addition to completing the online FERPA release form, this gives our staff on the CCBC side the ability to talk to authorized individuals that you designate, so likely your parents or maybe grandparents, aunts, uncles, whoever you designate in terms of financial aid and billing, that we can talk about those things with someone other than you. This does not cover academics. So due to FERPA, that student privacy regulations, we cannot ever discuss academics and grades with anyone other than the enrolled student. So I just want to make sure that I'm clear on what the FERPA waiver actually entails. Summer orientation dates are listed here. Two of those dates are going to change in July, so we'll have that updated on the website shortly. But just know that you will be required to come in for an in-person summer orientation date in June or July. We'll also have another virtual information session for students that have officially joined the program later in June, so that we can reiterate more about the schedule and the financial aid and billing process at that time. But as you're making your plans for your summer vacations, know that we do expect you to come to campus for a one-day summer in-person orientation date in June or July, depending on which one you choose. And your fall semester bill will be due by August 1st. So even though it seems like we're probably light years away from that, you want to do all of the preparation work that you can do in advance to ensure that you are prepared to pay your bill when it's assessed in the summer and ready to pay it on time when it's due by August 1st, because we do cancel unpaid students from the program for non-payment. We're required to by CCBC and Towson. So because we must make sure that students are financially cleared to participate in the program, you want to, again, do as much preparation as you can in advance to ensure that you're prepared to pay that bill later on this summer. So with that said, we will transition over to Mike Webster, our FTP financial aid administrator, and he will talk all things financial aid and billing.
Good evening, everybody. My name is Mike Webster. I am a financial aid administrator at CCBC on the Dundalk campus, and I handle the financial aid for the freshman transition program. So I'm going to talk briefly about the financial aid process and a little bit about the billing process as well. So hopefully you kind of all have started the financial aid process, if you are planning on using financial aid, that is, by filling out the FAFSA application. The FAFSA is the free application for federal student aid. It is a application that is used nationwide at all colleges. You could have started filling it out starting this past October 1st. So hopefully if you haven't done that already, you are getting ready to do that ASAP. All of the financial aid and the billing for the FTP program is done through CCBC rather than Towson. So because of that, we do operate on a little bit of a different schedule, us being a community college versus the four-year university. So if you've applied to a variety of four-year universities, you may have already heard from some schools in terms of financial aid award letters and that kind of thing. If you haven't, then you probably will shortly. CCBC, though, being a community college, we work on a little bit of a delayed schedule generally. So you won't be hearing from us financial aid wise specifically until later on in the summer. So you want to kind of get your planning process started in the meantime now to kind of know what you're looking at. And so there are kind of just two things that you want to be doing right now financial aid wise. Number one is making sure that the CCBC school code is on your FAFSA application. So you can return to the FAFSA website, FAFSA.gov, and add our school code. It's there on the screen. It's 002063. Now, your FAFSA can go to up to 10 schools at a time. So what we always recommend is that you just add our school code to it rather than replacing Towson school code or replacing another school with the CCBC code. Just make sure the CCBC is one of the 10, and you want to also leave Towson as one of the 10 as well. And the reason for that is hopefully everyone will be making that transition after the first semester. And so that way Towson already has access to your FAFSA application for that second semester, spring 24, and you won't have to do anything additional with your FAFSA application for them to have it and for them to make you a financial aid award for that particular semester. So again, just go back to the FAFSA website, add the CCBC school code if it's not already on there as one of your 10. Do not remove Towson school code. If you have already done that, you may just want to revisit the website just to make 100% sure that it does include the CCBC school code on there. Again, 002063. The other thing you want to be doing is reviewing the information on the FTP program's website. It's towson.edu/FTP. There is a specific web address if you want to skip right to the financial aid stuff. It's towson.edu/FTPFinAid. It's on your screen there now. And review all of that information. It's all really important, but you especially want to pay attention to two things. When you go to the forms section, so there will be a link to forms on the right side of the screen, And under the fall 2023 heading, you will see two forms, especially that you want to pay attention to. One is called how much aid will I receive? And that goes over what kind of financial aid is available to you for the first semester in the FTP program. And then there's also the expense worksheet, which is a worksheet that you can use to estimate what you're looking at owing bill-wise for the first semester. Now there's two versions of the expense worksheet. One is printable, you print it out, and it has instructions for you to hand fill out and do math. The other one is fillable, that it kind of just asks you questions and you answer them and it does the math for you to estimate what you're looking at for a bill for the first semester. Again, when you get to that website and you look for the forms, you want to make sure you're under the fall 2023 heading. We do still have some forms on the website for the current semester and the current FTP students still for the spring 23 semester. So just make sure that you're looking at the right forms there. Now, for the FTP program, we do things one semester at a time as opposed to one academic year at a time, like you would most expect. And that's because we don't know yet which students are going to transition out of the program at the end of the semester and which are going to continue in the program for a second semester. We obviously, of course, are shooting for 100% of students to transition out after the first semester, but we don't know exactly what's going to happen there. So for the first academic year, we do things one semester at a time. So for right now, we're just going to deal just with the upcoming fall 2023 semester. So when you fill out the expense worksheet and when you look at the how much aid will I receive document, that's just going to be relating to the first semester there. And so that'll get you started on the planning process in terms of what financial aid is going to be available to you and also what kind of bill you're looking at owing for that first semester. So Becca, you can go to the next slide, please. And that's the forms link on the right side of the screen there. So you can get to this, that stuff. So this is an estimated cost for the program. Again, just for the first semester. This is per semester, not per year. So first of all, keep in mind that, you know, as Ms. Gear mentioned earlier, living on campus is not required. So if you're not going to be living on campus, if you're not going to be utilizing a meal plan, those things are not required. So you can kind of subtract that out from this for yourself. But this is kind of what you're looking at owing potentially for that first semester. Again, just one single semester. So CCBC tuition rates are what applies to students in the FTP program. So regular Towson students pay one of two tuition rates, either in state or out of state. At CCBC, though, us being a community college, we have three tuition rates. We have a tuition rate for Baltimore County residents. We have a separate tuition rate, which we call out of county, which is for students that live in the state of Maryland, but in a different state other than Baltimore County. And this would include Baltimore City. And then we have a third tuition rate for students that live outside of the state of Maryland, out of state tuition. So depending on where you live is which tuition rate you will pay. And so you'll see there kind of how everything breaks down per semester. So if you're a Baltimore County resident and you're living on campus, you can be looking at just under $11,000 per semester. If you are a resident of the state of Maryland, but not Baltimore County, you're looking at just under like $13,000 per semester. And if you're a resident of a state other than the state of Maryland and choosing to live on campus again, you're looking at like $14,500 per semester. Now, keep in mind, these are just estimates. When you get your actual bill, it will vary from this. This is kind of just a ballpark to get you started. This is based on our current rates for 22-23. Those can potentially change for 23-24. We don't know until the early summer if that is going to happen. So these are based on our current rates. They are also based on some of the more popular or more common selections for things that you'll have some options for. So like meal plans, for example, and housing, for example, you have some options to choose from. What we've listed in the chart here is kind of what's most common. So just keep in mind, this is kind of a ballpark figure to get you started on the planning process. Your actual bill will definitely vary from these amounts, but this will get you started. There are monthly payment plans if you want to pay monthly to break down the payments, and those are available through the CCBC Bursar's office as well. Can you go to the next slide, please, Becca? So this is the contact information if you have any questions. So step one, again, is to review that website and review all that information there, especially the two forms that we mentioned, how much aid will I receive, and the expense worksheet. That'll kind of get most of you started in terms of what's available financial aid-wise and what you're looking at owing for that first semester bill-wise. But if you have additional questions, please shoot me an email. It's mwebster2@ccbcmd.edu. This is our busiest time of year. I also handle financial aid for just our regular CCBC student body as well, in addition to the FTP program. So this is our busiest time of year in terms of preparing for the upcoming fall semester. So the best thing to do is to contact me by email. You'll receive a response within 2 business days for sure. Also on the screen there, you'll see our mailing address and fax number. If you need to submit any kind of documents to our office, this is how you would do it. You want to definitely especially pay attention to the labeling. So you want to make sure that you're labeling everything that you submit to us as attention FTP. And the reason for that is, again, I also deal with all of the regular CCBC student body in terms of financial aid. So if you don't label your documents as attention FTP, they kind of go to the bottom of the pile with all of the documents that we're receiving from all of our regular CCBC students. And we get to it when we get to it. If you label it as attention FTP, it gets pulled out of the pile and it goes to me specifically to make sure it gets to the right person who handles this particular program and that it gets processed in a much more timely manner. So it's very important that you label everything that you're sending us as attention FTP. Next slide, please, Becca. Okay, so this is kind of the most important piece of the whole thing. You need to be on top of your TU email, your at students.towson.edu email, that is once you get access to it, very regularly, at least once a week. And you need to be reading over very carefully everything that you receive there. And if you want, you can share that information with your parents or anyone else who might be assisting you with financing your education. If you don't know anything about the financial aid process, if you didn't listen to anything I just said at all whatsoever, as long as you're on top of those emails and reading them carefully, you're not going to miss a thing. Those emails go over everything about the process and everything about what you need to do to get your financial aid and your bill taken care of. So what will happen is we'll start sending out emails to students that start very general, that are just about like generally for every student, how the process works and what you need to do. As the summer goes on, those emails will get much more specific though. Eventually we get to the point where we send all the students weekly email updates that kind of update them on where they stand specifically with the process, how much financial aid they have, what kind of bill they owe, if they owe any money on top of the financial aid, so if the financial aid isn't enough to cover their full bill, what is the difference there that they still owe? If they owe any financial aid documents to us, all that stuff gets sent to you to your TU email account once a week. Again, as Ms. Gear mentioned earlier, there are some privacy laws in effect, so we can't send those kinds of emails to your parents or anyone else. We send them only to the students. If you want your parents to be assisting you with this process, it's kind of your responsibility to forward those emails when you receive them to your parents so that they have that information as well. But again, this is the most important piece because as long as you are reading over those emails very carefully, you're not going to miss a thing. You're going to know everything about how the process works, about where you stand in the process, whether or not you owe us money, when that money is due, et cetera. So the most important thing to take away here today is to keep on top of that email. And at the end here, we're going to be taking questions. So if you have any questions about the financial aid process, let me know, but you can also shoot me an email. But again, I highly recommend you start with that website because that's going to kind of answer the vast majority of your questions. Thanks a lot.
Great. Thank you so much. So at this point, we're going to transition into our question and answer piece. So Becca, if you would please stop the recording. And